I ask for your prayer that I may preach God's word worthily and well, and that we may hear him and put what we hear into practice. Amen. Thank you. The families here, and all families, are called to be a domestic church. That means to be a church within the home. And that can mean that there's many dimensions to that, but we can focus today on the example of the Holy Family. And the word is obedience. We have spoken about obedience over the past several weeks, obedience to Jesus Christ and his church. And that could be so difficult as a family, especially because of all the things that assault the family from the outside. There are all kinds of forces, economic forces, for example. It is very hard to be marketable as one who works and also is family, whether it be a mother or a father. Those who are willing to compromise time with family in order to work extra hours gets the advantage, and it is very difficult in our economy to be a good family, to spend time with family when there are so many hours of work every single week. There's also that which assaults from the outside regarding matters of sexuality. We can think of all of the different ways also that marriage is attacked, the attempt to redefine it as if it is a thing that we can just play with, or in ways that that also denigrate marriage because it is considered by so many a contract. As long as my spouse behaves and does X, Y, and Z, we will stay married, a condition for fidelity. And the culture that we see on television also makes marriage appear as something that is secondary, as something that is optional for couples that wish to live together in order to express their love, making marriage out to be a mere expression of one's own commitment to each other, in which case there's no point to marriage. And then we have all kinds of attacks on the family with regard to virtue, how to be virtuous parents, how to be virtuous children. There is a youth culture that nourishes a sense of rebellion against parents and parental authority. The schools can also be hostile against parents. In so many ways, schools, especially in the secular arena, seeks to take away parents or take power away from parents, the place of the parents. I remember when I was a pastor of Resurrection Catholic School, sitting down with the HISD board and the president as well, and there was a lot of conversation about how many of the public schools in HISD didn't have a PTO, which is can be a crucial element for the place of the family, the place of the parents, in educating the children. So there's all kinds of things that make being a good, holy, obedient to God family. Now there are three things that I propose to you as a remedy, as a safeguard against these things that make being a holy family, that make that being very difficult. So the first is the spiritual leadership of the father in the household, which is very important. Now we heard from the second reading, that which is considered controversial in our modern time, which has sought to make not just men and women equal, which is good because men and women are equal in dignity before the Lord, but actually mix up the roles. Instead of saying women are equal to men, they say women are to be men. And men are denigrated in so many different ways in the popular culture. And the importance of the role of the father in many ways has been reduced or distorted. But men are meant to be the spiritual leader of the household. We hear it from St. Paul. He's very clear about that, about the leadership of the father and the obedience of the wife to her husband. Now again, this can cause all kinds of emotional triggers for people to think, well, now father is saying that women are to be like second rate to their husbands. Well, consider the fact that we elect political leaders to be in charge, but we don't consider them our superiors, do we? It's the same kind of thing happening on a more sacred level between the husband and the wife, that the wife is obedient in the sense that she is part of that role of the family, of honoring our Lord, and preserving the unity of the family. And the husband, now St. Paul here is very innovative. This was not something that was heard of in the ancient world, where he's showing that the man, the husband, must be like Christ, to love his wife as Christ loves his church, as if she was his own body. Equality. There's equality between both. And that the man must be like Christ, who laid down his life for his church, for his people. So we can see this dynamic, and I can tell you from my own experience in visiting many, many families, the ones who have the greatest harmony and that are the most successful and the happiest are those where the father has the spiritual household of the family. I know there's one family that I've been friends with going back to the days before they were married. The man I've been friends with since I was a freshman in college. And I went to visit them recently, and I remember the wife telling me, sometimes it's hard for me to be obedient to my husband. And she said that part of the reality is that I trust my husband because I know that he is going to respect me and our family. And we also know that a husband can't simply do whatever he wants, if that's even going to work out. In fact, I would even say that the times when the wife takes over the leadership of the household is when the man abdicates his authority, particularly by being absent in the faith. A man who has given up his faith and decides to live as he wishes, according to human or modern terms, has abdicated his leadership, and the woman should take over at that moment. Which leads me to the other aspect of spiritual fatherhood. Now, there was a recent study that showed that children who grow up and end up leaving the church, abandon their faith, 90% of the time, their fathers did the same. 90% of the time, even when the mother was faithful in raising up the children in the faith and did her best. What is happening there? What is the mystery there? It's very profound. And then another aspect of fatherhood that must be addressed is the assault of pornography, the scourge of pornography in married life. And let's face it, men are the ones that struggle with this far more than women. And I hear it in confession all the time. Pornography is a lie. St. John Paul II said that the evil of pornography isn't that it shows too much, but that it shows too little, because it obscures the beauty of sexuality within the family. It teaches the man to see women as objects of pleasure, because that's exactly what he is doing when he's looking at pornography. It leads to unrealistic expectations of what a relationship is to be with a woman. And it also saps away the emotional dynamism that a man has to have, that a husband has to have, that a father has to have in his family. Men, if you are struggling with pornography, the first step is confession, right? Because it is a grave sin. That is the first step in order to receive the mercy and healing grace of our Lord. And if you're finding that you're going to confession and you keep falling, go back to confession. Don't give up. Stay in the struggle. And if it's something that feels like an addiction, get help from someone else. You know, we have Rejoice Counseling, for example, but really seek out good help, good aids to help you with that. So spiritual fatherhood is indispensable in the family. And men, if you struggle with that, with being faithful, just ask St. Joseph for help. And St. Joseph who listened to the angel in order to serve his wife, the Virgin Mary, who, by the way, outranks him in holiness, right? She's called the Queen of the Apostles. And so women can look at that as an example of how to live in the family. So that's the first thing, is the spiritual leadership of fathers in the household. The second is patience in the family. And boy, that's something that I constantly hear from families. Father, how can I be more patient with my wife? How can I be more patient with my husband? How can I be more patient with my children? Children say the same thing. How can I be more patient with my parents? How can I be more patient with my brother or with my sister? And a lot of times, I don't know the answer. If you find that out, let me know, because I struggle with the same thing, right? There's no magic bullet. But look at the mystery of what patience, where that word actually comes from. Because sometimes we can think that patience means that I don't feel agitated anymore or angry anymore or bothered anymore by what my family does. But that's not what patience is. Patience is connected to the Latin term passeo, which is also the root word of the passion. Are you hearing something there that's familiar? The passion of the Lord, right? Patience and the passion of the Lord are really the same thing, which means to suffer willingly, to suffer with love, loving patience, not mere tolerance, but loving patience, to be willing to bear with one another, as St. Paul talks about in the letter today, to be centered on the peace of Jesus Christ who guides us. So that to help us see more clearly then, when we are struggling with the emotions that can really hijack our logic, our ability to reason within situations, and a good check against the inclination to act out of wrath, to act out of bitterness, whatever it may be, a good check on that is to be centered on Jesus Christ, to be centered on the kind of love that he shows. Love, which means to desire and to act on the welfare of the other, to desire their happiness and to act on that. And where do we get happiness? We get it from Jesus. Jesus is the one that leads us to eternal happiness. And eternal salvation is the most important thing for all the members of the family. Another way to think about it that could be very helpful is that when we are being patient, loving, to be respectful of the other, to act in accordance with the laws of the church, the laws that we are taught, the inspiration of the saints, etc., on how to be good parents, good children, etc., that when it is hard to do so, when we act against the inclination to act on wrath, when it is hard, that's the moment when you are growing in holiness. That's the moment when you are growing closer to Jesus. That difficulty is selfishness leaving the soul. You're being purified. God gives us the gift of not choosing our family, right? Or in the case of spouses that exchange vows, that's the beginning of the growth in holiness. Because at that moment, after you exchange vows, you don't have the choice of leaving. You really don't, when it's a true marriage. So at that moment, those moments are times in which you are growing in holiness. So loving patience is indispensable. And then finally, the third thing, to grow as a family obedient to God. We see already in the example of Joseph. He listens to God through the voice of the angel, and he obeys. So we can't obey God unless we are actually listening to him. And the core of our listening to him is in prayer. Prayer. It's almost cliche to say that a family that prays together stays together, right? You've heard that before, I'm sure. And we can take that even deeper because it's not a magical formula, right? And I would say that a family that prays profoundly together stays together. And that means prayer being a daily rhythm of the family life, that faith is the center of the family. The Mass is the center of our prayer, so the Mass is the center of the family. Indeed, you're being nourished by the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. And when that happens, you become the body of Christ within your own family. And then taking up daily prayer. Again, I like to go back to the same family that I mentioned before. And I was very impressed when I stayed with them during some of my summer vacation. And they would get all their children together at night all six children, which is, I don't know how they do it, but they do, they make it work, right? They get them all together at night, and each member of the family, beginning with the father, offers up certain specific intentions for that evening. And they can come up with whatever it is, right? So the dad, he said, I pray for my mother who is sick right now. And then the wife says, I pray for my school because I'm in my class, which is going through a hard time. Or the and then the next kid prayed for peace throughout the world, right? All of these beautiful intentions going all the way around. Even a three-year-old has something to pray for. I don't remember what it was, but I remember it being very adorable. And then after that, they pray in Our Father, a Hail Mary, and a Glory Be, and they go to bed. How simple, but how powerful, right? How profound. And imagine that the family gets into an argument during that day, that something happens that causes strain in the family. But if that family ends the day in prayer, think about the kind of healing that leads to. Think about it, how it puts everything into context about who the family is, centered on Christ. And then one more point of advice within that prayer is to also read the sacred scriptures and also learn about the faith. That's all part of the prayer. And in particular, another practical point is to read the gospel and also the readings of the Sunday Mass that's coming up. Just pick a day when you do that as a family and then reflect on it for just a little bit. You don't have to give a theological reflection. The parents don't have to give a sermon necessarily, right? But to simply read about it in order to be ready for the Mass. And then after the Sunday Mass, and I remember my dad used to do this to me and I hated it. Of course, I didn't like going to Mass either, you know. Hope you're not scandalized by that, but I was a kid like anybody else. But after the Mass, I remember my dad would ask me, what did you hear in the gospel today? And what did you learn from the homily? Hopefully, you know, you're going to learn something from a homily if it's an effective homily. But that was something that helped me to pay attention and to continue to allow the faith to penetrate deeper into my heart as well as for the whole family. So in all of those ways, the spiritual leadership of the man in the household, loving patience, and a life of profound prayer. In all of these ways, a family can be like the Holy Family, obedient to our Lord Jesus Christ and His church, growing in holiness, and being that domestic church that the world so badly needs. Let's pray to Mary, to Joseph, and to Jesus to help us in that.